On May 14th of 2021, the Zhurong rover landed on the surface of Mars, this making China the second country ever to land a rover on the Red Planet. In this video, we will talk about the goals of the Zhurong rover, where exactly it landed on Mars, and how the rover compares to some of NASA's Mars rovers. So let's talk about that. The name of the rover is Zhurong, which I hope I'm pronouncing correctly. This comes from Chinese mythology or history as the god of fire. Now, ultimately, the goals of the rover match very similar to other previous missions to reach the surface of Mars. This being to uncover some of the geological components of the landing site and studying the atmospheric sciences around the region, to try and gain more insight into the Martian environment as a whole, and also looking for resources that could potentially be used for future missions to Mars when humans are involved. But before we get into more of the details of what exactly these goals are, we need to recognize where on the Red Planet Zhurong actually landed, because what goals you define for your mission are going to determine in where exactly you land. Zhurong landed in a plane on Mars called Utopia Planitia. So let's take a look at a map to see where exactly this is. Now here we can see the landing site as a whole for the rover. And by looking at a topological map, we can see the elevation in which it landed at, where a bluer area is associated with a lower elevation, and the more red or white area is associated with a higher elevation on the planet. So we can see that Zhurong landed in a low elevation area. And this corresponds to what the Chinese National Space Agency had claimed. One of their goals for selecting a landing site was picking a region that has a low elevation. The reason for this is because landing anything on the surface of Mars is relatively challenging. You have to deal with the fact that there is an atmosphere, which means you can use it to slow down. However, it's not like Earth's atmosphere where just deploying a parachute would be enough. Instead, you have to also use retro rockets like you're landing on the moon. So it's quite a challenging combination in order to land anything on the surface of Mars, which is why many missions to the Red Planets in the past have failed. However, in selecting a lower elevation, that means there's more of an atmosphere to help you slow down, which is why one of the reasons that they selected this region. Now, I should also mention that these same landing site criteria are used for NASA rovers as well. In fact, when selecting Jezero Crater for the Perseverance rover, one of the constraints in selecting the landing site as a whole was that the elevation or the altitude had to be 0.5 kilometers below the average elevation on Mars. And by looking back at that topological map, we could see that anywhere that's a yellowish green, green, or blue region would fulfill this criteria, which actually takes away a lot of the Martian surface. So even though this was a constraint that was put on the Zhurong rover, NASA still fulfills this constraints in their own selection process. So that's one of the reasons why they selected Utopia Planitia, but there are other reasons as well. Again, to select an area which is easier to land in, they want to try and avoid locations that have large cliff sides, valleys, or craters, to make sure that they don't reach a region which could be potentially harmful for the rover or lander. Therefore, they had to select this plain-like area to try and fulfill those criteria. Now, this Utopia Planitia is also a location where NASA had previously landed, specifically the Viking 2 lander back in 1976. Now, although Viking 2 landed at a higher latitude, here is a panoramic image from the Viking 2 lander. If we compare this to a similar panorama that was taken by the Perseverance rover, we can clearly see that Utopia Planitia is a much more flat terrain, which is going to aid in the landing of anything on the surface of Mars. But there is also a major scientific reason as to why you might want to land something here. So in order to understand this, let's take a look back at that elevation image. Again, we see that the bluer regions are associated with lower elevation, which primarily occur in the northern hemisphere. Now, some planetary scientists associate this with being a region in which an ancient ocean existed on Mars. Although this topic is debatable whether or not Utopia Planitia was once an ancient ocean bed, However, it's important to note that recent studies have shown that there is vast quantities of water ice beneath the surface. Therefore, if you're interested in understanding more about how exactly you can collect ice or find deposits of ice on Mars, then you might want to send your rover to a location where a large amount of water ice exists, which is one of the reasons why they selected this landing site. So now that we know where exactly the Zhurong rover is on the surface of Mars, we can take a look at the actual goals of the mission. The rover will analyze the Martian environment, specifically looking at the geological composition of rocks and minerals, analyzing the soil and potential for water ice, and understanding the atmosphere in the region. Now, Zhurong has 6 experiments on board in order to help address these questions, ranging from cameras and weather stations to a ground-penetrating radar to try and detect water ice underneath the surface. And this image shows where exactly some of these cameras and instruments are placed on the rover itself. So from this design, we can discuss the specifications. Zhurong has a mass of 240 kilograms and has dimensions of 2.6 meters wide, 3 meters long, and 1.85 meters tall. And the rover is powered by solar energy, or using solar panels. Now, before we compare the Zhurong rover to some of NASA's rovers, let's first take a look at some of the pictures that they've sent back from the surface of Mars. Here, we can see a picture before the rover drove off of the lander that helped it reach the surface of the red planet. Here is after the rover left the lander and is now actually on the surface of Mars. Now, the mission has planned to last for 90 sols, or 90 Martian days, which is equivalent to roughly 92 Earth days. Now, with that being said, most of these missions that go to Mars or the Moon or really anywhere in space last much longer than their lifespan. So I wouldn't be surprised if Zhurong is lasting for years or maybe even a decade, similar to what the Opportunity rover was able to do. So lastly, let me compare Zhurong to some of NASA's Mars rovers. But let me also mention that comparing between different rovers, different missions, even going to different landing sites, is not really a fair comparison. It's like comparing apples to oranges. The mission objectives are different, the agencies that it's coming from are different, and even the time frame in which this technology came about is different. Therefore, it isn't easy to say that one rover is clearly better than another, but rather that it provides different opportunities to learn about the Martian environment. So that being said, let's start with some of the basic specifications by looking at the mass of Zhurong compared to some of the other rovers. So the Mars exploration rovers, Spirit and Opportunity, were slightly less massive than Zhurong. However, Curiosity and Perseverance are more massive, as you can see by this graphic. We can also relate Zhurong to the Mars exploration rovers being Spirit and Opportunity. And these have a major comparison in the fact they are solar powered. Now, solar panels can be somewhat of a challenge on Mars because of the collection of dust that we've seen more recently from the InSight lander. Now, the reason why this isn't always a problem is because there are cleaning events that can blow dust off of the solar arrays, therefore making it again very efficient or similar to how it was when it first landed on Mars. However, there are some other challenges. One of the challenges associated with global dust storms, which although Spirit and Opportunity were able to survive through a fair share of these events, it ultimately led for the end of Opportunity by going through one of these dust storms. Now, although as of right now and during the next 90 sols, it isn't anticipated there's going to be a dust storm because it's not the right season on Mars. However, it is possible that one could happen within the next couple years, which could be a challenge to the rover. Additionally, the seasons on Mars, that can be quite challenging as well. Although for the next roughly 9 months or so on Mars, it will be spring and going into summer, where Zhurong won't face much of a challenge in the Northern Hemisphere, because ultimately it'll have a lot of sunlight in order to keep it powered. However, once it gets into fall and winter, it might need to slow down its scientific observations and primarily focus on staying alive. And this is very similar to what Spirit and Opportunity had to do. In some cases, they even had to climb up a certain hill in order to get more solar power to stay alive. So ultimately, if it does surpass its 90 sol limit and goes much longer into years or maybe even a decade, it'll be interesting to see if they follow many of the procedures that were followed for Spirit and Opportunity. Now, to provide a basic comparison between the instruments on Zhurong to NASA's rovers is looking at what exactly exists. Remember, the goal is to understand the geological composition of the environment as well as the atmospheric sciences. So a lot of the instruments relate again back to the Spirit and Opportunity rovers, understanding the geological composition that exists nearby. And also, some components relate to the Perseverance and Curiosity rovers, where Zhurong has a laser-induced spectrometer that is able to determine the composition of some minerals. So ultimately, you could say that it's essentially a combination of some of these types of rovers. And to go even further, Zhurong, as I mentioned, has a ground-penetrating radar, which can go down to 100 meters in looking for water ice. Now, the Perseverance rover has a similar experiment, but it can go down to 10 meters, looking at the different density of the soil. Now, one major difference between Zhurong and some of NASA's recent Mars rovers is the fact that it does not have a robotic arm. This might pose a challenge when trying to take images close up to a certain mineral or rock structure. However, they might be able to overcome this depending on how exactly their cameras are set up. Ultimately, it's hard to compare any rover to another. Take, for example, again, Spirit and Opportunity. They're essentially the exact same design, but because of where they landed on Mars resulted in completely different amounts of data and insight about the red planet. The last thing that I should mention, which is fairly impressive, is the fact that Zhurong is a part of the larger Tianwen-1 mission. But what does that mean? Tianwen-1 also includes an orbiter, which is able to relay the data back from the rover all the way to Earth. Meaning that in this one mission, they included the orbiter, the lander which landed the rover on Mars, and the rover itself, which is quite a lot, especially looking at the size of the rover that it sent. So hopefully we'll be able to hear more about what is found on Mars in Utopia Planitia through the Zhurong rover, and whether or not there are vast quantities of water ice beneath the surface. If you enjoyed this video, please consider leaving a like and subscribing to this channel if you want to learn more about space exploration and the future of humanity in space. But with all that being said, thank you for watching, and I hope to see you in the next one.